time for the fan favorite segment, the Fan Zone, where we discuss international football. And just to kick us off, Chelsea against West Ham United, sorry, against Crystal Palace has just kicked off 2:30 p.m. East African time. And we shall be getting to you with updates from that particular clash. Early kickoff one. Remember, later on, Leeds United, the newly promoted, up against the team that finished second in last season's campaign, Manchester City. Will City continue with their slow start to Premier League campaign, or Leeds, will they continue with their glittering show after promotion? Time will tell. In the next few hours, of course, we shall be getting an opportunity to watch that particular game. Of course, updates from Nyayo National Stadium, where Kip Keino World Continental Tour is happening. Amazing run by Paul Tanui, the veteran, to win 10,000 meters happening at Nyayo National Stadium. Remember, the event just kicked off a few minutes ago, and Paul Tanui has won the men's 10,000 meters race. Of course, he cemented his lead at the top with 5 laps to go, and the pace just started to get quicker. Of course, we shall also be getting to you with much details of what is happening at the Nyayo National Stadium, the facility that was launched 2 weeks ago by President Uhuru Kenyatta. But delving straight into the Fan Zone, Ken, good to see you, man. How have you been?
I've been okay. It's great to be back with you here to discuss some football, and let's get to it.
Let's get to it indeed. Yeah. So City against Leeds. No, before we get to City against Leeds, what is happening right now? Chelsea against Crystal Palace. Where are you putting your money?
Yeah, that's a very tricky game for Chelsea. Yeah, so I'd put my money on them. They have to. I've seen he has made some big changes in the squad. Rhys James is out, and Tammy Abraham is back up front. And I think he really wants to win this game. He, Frank Lampard, because he's had dismal performances in the cup and his last two Premier League games. But Crystal Palace are no slump. They're no walkover. You see, they had a great match against Everton last week. They just lost it, and they're flying at the start of the campaign. So I have my money on Chelsea, but Palace won't be a walkover for anyone.
Wilfred Zaha, how much influence is he to this particular game?
Yeah, I think he's a very big influence. He's been named the captain for a couple of games, the one at Old Trafford and also the one last week. And he's their best player. He's always wanted by big clubs around Europe. Some
PSG.
Say, yeah, PSG. Some say if Sancho leaves, he might replace him at Dortmund. He's always been their biggest player, who wants the most. And he always has great performances, can run with the ball a very long distance, can win penalties. And he's also a good leader in a way that he leads by example for most of the players.
What's the problem at Stamford Bridge? I tend to believe that people are heaping much blame on Frank Lampard, yet it's too early. It's just 3 games since the league commenced, and already football fans have already started saying that Frank Lampard is very incompetent, is very clueless with his tactics, despite the signings he made. I think over 7 signings he made during the just concluded transfer window. Actually, it's getting concluded on Monday.
Yes.
So what is really happening? Too early to blame Lampard?
Yeah, for me I'd say it's too early, because you look back at the last time they won the league with Antonio Conte, they didn't start strong, and that brought in a couple of great players. N'Golo Kante was coming into that team. There were a couple of good players. They didn't play well. They had a dismal match against Arsenal when they were starting, but at the end they won the league, and it's only been 3 games for them. Okay, they haven't performed well, especially the Liverpool one was okay. They had a red card and stuff, but the West Brom one, they didn't perform well. There were some uncharacteristic mistakes from big players, Thiago Silva, and they can happen, but they shouldn't be happening at Chelsea. And so going forward, they've already played 3 games. Moving forward from today, I think Chelsea should, the players should gel better, they should work better together and try to bring more results, because they have signed pure quality, great players. None of the players is subpar or whatever, because you've seen they've also brought in a new keeper who had a great debut against Tottenham. Yeah, so the players they've brought in are pure quality, and I expect them to work together, and Chelsea will finish strong this season. So it's too early to really judge Frank Lampard at the moment.
Let's delve into what happened in midweek. UEFA Champions League draw being conducted. United, your team, up against You know, the runners-up for Champions League last season, the French moneybacks, Paris Saint-Germain, RB Leipzig, which got eliminated, I think, at the semi-final stage, and Istanbul. People saying that that's a group of deaths. What are your take-home points from that particular draw?
Yeah, that was scary for United fans, you know, because you have to play a team which went into the semi-final and one which actually went to the final and lost by a slim margin of 1-0 to the great Bayern Munich. And United coming in, they finished third in the league. We thought that the team was going to get the big signings that we wanted, the flair signings, but we haven't until now. United have only signed one player.
Yes.
And when you sit down and compare it to the, for example, Paris is the biggest team in that club. You compare it to the depth of Paris, you'll just be shocked at how United are. We are even scared to play against Leipzig at this moment because we don't feel like the squad is big enough to have all these players, to have all these games against these big clubs in such a short period of time. And also, it's the Champions League. We have the dark horses, yes. Istanbul, Basaksehir. You know, we've seen some great performances from smaller teams in the Champions League. There was Roma, Ajax, there's also Lyon. And you never know, this is the Champions League. So Istanbul is also a sport where people might want to see. But we still remain hopeful. This is United. We can get it done.
Yeah. Is it a smooth sailing for the defending champions Bayern Munich after getting pulled alongside Atletico Madrid, Salzburg and Lokomotiv Moscow in Group A? How easy is it for them to get to the next stage? Because I think as it looks like, you know, they only have big opponent in Atletico, which has not been doing equally good.
Yeah. They only have to play Atletico, the biggest club in that group. And you look at Salzburg and Lokomotiv Moscow.
Yes.
They're also strong clubs in that Salzburg last season, they had a great run in the group stages. Although they didn't make out of it, they had Haaland, Minamino. They were a good club. But when you compare them right now, they've lost their biggest stars to Bayern and Atleti. It's hard to see them making it past the group stage. And the same goes for Moscow. Okay, they also met Atletico last time. They gave them a bit trouble, but Atletico went through. So for that group, I can predict Bayern and Atleti going through in that order.
Inter Milan looks set to play against Real Madrid, and I think that will be a crunch match.
Yeah,
of course, Antonio Conte up against Zinedine Zidane. And, you know, that will be, you know, a competition pitting clubs from dominant football nations, Italy and Spain. But in that particular group as well, we have Shakhtar Donetsk and Mönchengladbach. Easy for Inter and Real to cruise through?
I'd say easy for Real, but Inter, in the Champions League, the past two seasons, they've had inconsistent performances. I remember their first game last season, they drew 1-1 with a team from Czech Republic, and they did manage to play well against Dortmund. So for Real, I think they'll make it easily through the group. But Inter, I'd like to see them. They've brought in some firepower. There's Hakimi has come in and Kolarov. Yeah, I think we just have to wait and see them play. Shakhtar is also a tricky team to play against. It's always in the Champions League. They always qualified. They always offer they give big upsets in Europe sometimes. But for Inter, they need to be on their game and they need to play well to actually go past that group.
Porto, a team from Portugal, one-time Champions League win, and I think the only time they did that was under the tutelage of Jose Mourinho in Group C alongside Manchester City, which got eliminated at the quarterfinal stage of last season's campaign. Olympiacos from Greece and Marseille from France are also in that particular group. Tricky, though manageable?
Yeah, for City, I don't think that's tricky for Man City. In the Champions League, they always seem to get these kinds of draws. They always have no big names in the groups. For the past three seasons, I think they've played Shakhtar Donetsk. Last season, they had Atalanta. They were beating teams 5-0 away. They were sailing through smooth. So for them, I think that the real competition will be against the other three teams. And I see Porto making it through because they missed the round of 16 last season only in three seasons. So for City, okay, as a United fan, as fans of other English clubs, we think City and Chelsea have the easiest draws and they can sail into the round of 16 without any big problems.
Group D has got six-time Champions League winners Liverpool and 2019 conquerors,
yeah.
And Ajax Amsterdam
yeah.
is also included in that particular group, and we all remember them for their heroic exploits
yeah.
during 2019-2020 campaign. They got eliminated at the semi-final
yeah.
stage, and I think that's the time we got to see these names that have been hijacked
yeah.
by other clubs who have really engaged in hiring
yeah.
players from that particular side, leading to exodus, the likes of ZH
yeah.
and, you know, Van de Beek joining
yeah.
United.
Yeah.
I think Barcelona also signed someone.
De Jong.
De Ligt joining
yeah.
Juventus. So,
yeah.
Liverpool up against Ajax, Atalanta
yeah.
as well in that particular group after
yeah.
surprising many,
yeah.
contrary to expectation, they performed very well during
yeah.
the just concluded campaign and Midtjylland.
Yeah, Midtjylland. Yeah.
Midtjylland is also in that particular.
Yeah, I think apart from Midtjylland, what we can expect from Liverpool, Ajax, and Atalanta are goals, because you look at Atalanta last season, they beat teams like they beat AC Milan 5-0. They are never afraid of going forward. They always attack, even with the centre backs at the sides of the three. They always attack. They always score a lot of goals. And we know Liverpool, they have flair players. They have some of the greats. Mo Salah, Jota now, Mane, they can score goals. And Ajax, they always, even though their big names have left, you know, they have a good youth system. They always seem to bring new great players every time, and we can't wait to see who will step up for Ajax this time, because I think they will finish second or first, yeah, depending on how Liverpool actually play. They can choose to like maul all of them and go over all of them, but Ajax will offer the biggest challenge for Liverpool. I'm not writing off Atalanta, but I think when they attack, if you want to play football and attack a team like Liverpool, it will really hurt you, because they have one of the greatest ever attacks in football.
So the experts of Europa League and specialists of the same, Sevilla.
Yeah.
Of course, by the virtue of winning Europa League, I think they qualified for Champions League, and they
yeah.
have won it
yeah.
Three times running.
Yeah, they won it three times running, and then they won it last year, this year against Inter Milan, then they eliminated Man United. But yeah.
So, up against Chelsea in that particular group, Krasnodar as well, and Rennes from France. Easy for Sevilla and Chelsea?
Easy for Sevilla and Chelsea. Yeah, but I won't be shocked if Sevilla drop out and head into the Europa League. I don't know. They have something with that competition. But looking at the strength of the squads, Chelsea should walk over this group and make it to the round of 16. Rennes from France, it's a tricky team. I'd say that's the tricky team. Krasnodar isn't quite in the same ilk as the other three clubs. But if Chelsea play well, they'll top the group. And the other two teams will have to battle for second. That's what I think.
Okay, Group F has got Zenit St. Petersburg, Borussia Dortmund, Lazio, and Club Brugge, Belgian champions. What are the permutations of, you know, two teams from that particular group qualifying to the next stage? Because they look like all of them have same strengths.
Yeah. Those are the kinds of tricky groups
pools.
Because you find all the teams are evenly matched. People might think Dortmund is way ahead, but we also have Lazio,
yes.
who you might think are way ahead, but at the same point, Zenit were the champions of Russia. So when you look at a table like that one, it's hard to predict who's coming out of that group. If Dortmund lose a couple of players in the coming 3 days, it might be hard for them, because the other three teams are coming to play and they have nothing to lose. We are already in the Champions League. Let's see how far we can go. So they'll try to give their all and actually beat Dortmund. But Dortmund, currently with Sancho, Haaland, I expect them to finish top and make it to the round of 16 easily.
Group G, what do you think of, you know, the competition, revival of competition
yeah,
that existed between Ronaldo and Messi? Now Messi will be up against Ronaldo, as Juventus and Barcelona have been pulled in the same group.
Yeah,
I think, alongside Dynamo Kiev.
Yeah, I think right now, the two clubs are going through the same thing. They've lost a couple of players, new managers coming in. They expect a lot from the players, and especially Barca. Barca, they've let go of some players who I think were still good, could have helped the club. Like they sold Artur to Juve,
yes.
and now they'll meet again with Pjanic. So I think it will be a tricky tie. I'm not so sure who will win it. They've both have strong starts to the campaign. Ronaldo looks great. Messi is on fire. Coutinho. But at the end of the day, you know, it will come down. Everyone will just come down to Messi versus Ronaldo once again after a couple of years. Not the El Clasico anymore, but the biggest club in Italy versus one of the two biggest clubs in Spain. Barca versus Juve. And it will be a crazy tie. But for me, I don't think Juve have enough quality, enough world-class players around Cristiano. Maybe one or two, but Barcelona, they are star-studded, they have big players, and I'd expect them to top that group even if Juventus are there, because I don't think Juventus are really quite that good at this at the moment right now.
So let's discuss the last group, which has been branded the Pool of Death, which has got United and Paris Saint-Germain. Yeah. And I saw a thread done by Marcus Rashford on Twitter on how Romelu Lukaku was so resourceful to their campaign, especially against Paris Saint-Germain during that Champions League tie where they managed to win 3-2, aggregate to qualify to the next stage. Will he be lucky to be, you know, of much influence to United again? Marcus Rashford, he's been praised for his good work on and off the pitch.
Yeah, I think Rashford is one of United's key players. You know, when you think of United, you think of their attack last season, especially at the back end, Bruno, Marcus, Anthony Martial, and Mason Greenwood. And maybe they should look
but too inexperienced at the big stage.
Yeah, too inexperienced. They haven't had Champions League football that much, but coming in, we've seen how they've played in the Premier League. They had 17 goals, him and Anthony Martial, and they've been at some grand. They've won at Juventus in the Champions League, and they've won at PSG. And I think the best thing about having a young squad is that they really want to play. They have a lot of hope in them. They know even if this is a big club, we can still go out and give our best, and we might win. And also, if you look at United's record under Ole against big clubs, it's actually quite good. We beat City three times last season. Chelsea, we did away with them. And you also beat PSG at their home in that crazy game. So going forward, I think Marcus Rashford will be crucial. But the most crucial at this in that group will be United's defence. Because if we can't concede, I think United can score.
So the provisional squad for England, 3 Lions ahead of their campaign against Wales, Denmark and is it Belgium? Yeah. We've seen new names. Calvert Lewin has been in good form for Everton. He's been scoring goals, and I think he's enjoying his form under Carlo Ancelotti at the Toffees. He's been included, and so is Harvey Barnes of Leicester and Bukayo Saka of Arsenal. But Mason Greenwood, after that incident, they've been dropped.
Yeah.
Deserving call-ups by for this trio?
I think the one I'd have out is I'd have Greenwood and Foden in, and actually have Harvey Barnes and Saka out. Not because they're bad players, but I think Greenwood and Foden, they've done it a long time at City and United, you know. They've been playing regularly, and they've got a certain amount of goals, and they've played in Europe. Yeah, so leaving them out because of a mistake, I believe they were already punished for when they didn't get to play the second in it.
But I think they're still kids. Yeah. Who can just be advised, told what to do, what's right and what's wrong.
So
and that's enough.
Yeah. But still, with Bukayo Saka, who is great at moving with the ball, a really good player, I think a lot of people are happy to see him. I'm also happy to see him get his call up because I think he's a really good player. And Harvey Barnes is a real hard worker, you know. He works a lot for Leicester. He might not get a lot of goals and all of that, but he works a lot alongside Jamie Vardy. He's a good player. Calvert-Lewin, you know, he's just been amazing at the start of the season. Two hat-tricks already, and he's very good in the air. Yeah, so let's see how they do.
Jadon Sancho, United is not actively involved in the transfer, and they are being ridiculed, being mocked by the opponents, because we've seen most clubs getting actively involved in strengthening their squads as the campaign for European leagues continue. But again, 100 million pounds bid for Jadon Sancho has been rejected by Borussia Dortmund. But we saw reports yesterday from Jamie Redknapp saying that, you know, that deal might go through in the next few hours before the transfer window clocks on Monday. How possible?
Yeah, for now, I don't think it's possible because a lot of people had their hopes. The moment United finished third, we thought Sancho is signed and sealed. We are getting our man. But it hasn't happened for the past ever since July, it hasn't happened yet. And also, you look at the amount of money United have been trying to offer. They're under Dortmund's valuation of 120 million. That's what they want. They want it up front, but United keep coming with the new and different ways to pay up, and I think they'll still do that, and that's why Dortmund won't sell. But I've seen they want to go for a couple of options. I've seen Ousmane Dembele, who I think is also
a good player.
Yeah, a really good player, but you know, very injury prone. Yeah, and there's also Ismaïla Sarr from Watford, whom I don't want to see him at United. We really prefer Sancho though. So let's hope and
why
pray.
Why don't you want to see Sarr?
You know, he's a good player. He's very good, but looking
not
at
that caliber for
yeah,
United.
Looking at the other two names, Dembele and Sancho in that list. You have to pick who will give more to United, who will a really top player, you know? And I think it's either Sancho or Dembele.
Wow, what else? I think we discussed about what happened during midweek. Several matches were played. Tottenham beat Chelsea.
Yeah, penalties.
In post-match penalties to qualify to the next stage of Carabao Cup. United also recorded a win against a team that had caused them sleepless nights in Premier League, Brighton. I don't know, which match did you watch yourself?
I watched both for Chelsea and for Man United. Chelsea, I think they should have taken a lot of their chances. Tottenham in the first half were nowhere to be seen. Chelsea, they had the better players on the pitch. They had everything. Tottenham more or less had their second string. Harry Kane was on the bench. I'd say only Lamela was a top player in that pitch, but Chelsea didn't capitalize. They equalized in 80-something minute.
Yes.
They got two penalties, and Mason Mount, a person who Lampard really, really, really loves, misses the penalty, and Tottenham are through. Mourinho was so excited. And for United against Brighton, it wasn't quite what happened in the Premier League because both teams rolled out more of their second string, so it wasn't as explosive as on Saturday. But, you know, United had a better depth, stronger squad from the bench. Guys like Mata, they came through, and it was a great finish, 3-0 into the quarters. Yeah, so let's see how it goes. But also, we had Liverpool versus Arsenal, which was in the 90 minutes was disappointing because Liverpool and Arsenal doesn't end 0-0. But they go to the penalties, and that's it. Arsenal win it. And
Ben Leno was sort of excited after, you know, saving a penalty. Yeah. And there was huge praise for him from both managers, Mikel Arteta and Jurgen Klopp. And he says that he felt he was the number one custodian at Arsenal. Yeah. I think before Emiliano, was he called Emiliano Martinez?
Before
he left, I think Leno was a little bit terrified
because
he knew his place was up for grabs.
Yeah.
How do you assess of his performance?
In
that particular game,
he had a great performance. A couple of saves were absolutely world class, and then he goes on to the penalty shootout and does his thing. He was Arsenal's best player in the pitch, and I think for a couple of games he's been Arsenal's best player. He's very good at making reflex saves and playing the ball with his feet for a goalkeeper. You know, that's usually a great thing these days. So he does those things very perfectly. The downside to him is, as good as he is, I feel kind of sad for him being around all these years at Leverkusen, at Arsenal, and not being able to get a run in the German national team. So that's the only downside to his career. But as a goalkeeper, he's strong. He makes great saves, and he's also a good ball player. So, yeah, Leno deserves all the praise.
So this afternoon's fixture, Chelsea up against Crystal Palace as we speak, 19th minute, still scoreless. Everton will be playing host to Brighton. Quite a good clash as well. Yeah, but Carlo Ancelotti, will he allow his charges to drop points?
Yeah, I don't.
Following his good form of late?
Yeah, I don't. Chelsea look, Everton look really strong. But when you look at Brighton this season, they're playing a certain type of football that is so exciting. They aren't afraid to go forward. You saw them against Chelsea and also against United. They have all these big names, but if we play the ball and keep it, we can beat them. And they'll look at Everton, as much as they are playing, they're not quite United, Chelsea. So they look at it as a game which we can win. So that's a very tasty clash. Yeah.
VR, I was forgetting before we end up the show. Yeah. Let's talk about VR. I once interviewed Francis Kimanzi, the coach for the national team Harambee Stars, and he told me VR is robotic. It slows down the pace of the game.
Yeah.
You remember that action between United and Brighton, the game had ended, final whistle had been blown.
Yeah.
Then VAR action
Indicated
that United had to take a penalty. Come on.
Yeah, I think that's the day and age we live in, you know. The game has evolved, obviously. Yes. Now they are using the video referee. And regarding that incident, I think if there was no VAR, it would have been missed because the guy seemed to push his...
So VAR is helpful?
Yeah, for me, it is helpful. It's the rules that govern it that should be checked, because sometimes you might concede a goal which you should have conceded, the offsides. I think those are justifiable, but some calls like the handball ball calls we've been seeing recently...
Yes.
They haven't been quite correct, I would feel. But that one for United was correct, not just because I'm a fan, but Maupay pushed his arm towards the ball, and even though the whistle went, VAR spotted it, and United was able to get what they deserved, really. But you look at another handball call during the week, Eric Dier, when he missed the ball, and then it was headed by Andy Carroll from behind him as he was going down the motion of his hands. And it hit his arm, and they gave a penalty for something which he could have controlled. Yeah, those are the sad calls, the handball calls. So for me, it's the handball rules and other nitty-gritties about clear and obvious errors that have to be sorted, but I am okay with VAR.
Tomorrow, it looks like a Super Sunday in the world of athletics, London Marathon, then in football, Tottenham up against United. Jose Mourinho, my guy.
Yeah.
You saw his antics on the touchline with Frank Lampard, both of them downplayed the rift between themselves. Now up against a team he coached some time back, United. What is your assessment? Where are you putting your money? Are you just remaining a supporter?
I'm going to
hoping United will cruise through.
Yeah, I'm going to put my money. Not hoping they cruise through. I think United, they are a lot better than Spurs. Although they have made good signings, I think United should win this game. Because I feel like, they played twice last season and United didn't look really weak. Tottenham were sat back, and that's exactly what they are going to do, you know. Jose thinks he's going to have, because he knows United, when they go forward, they are really strong. So he looked to capitalize on their somehow shaky defense, Lindelof and the left back side. So they'll try to capitalize in that while sitting back. And it's also a super game in that these two teams... are the two of the top six at Old Trafford. Obviously, it's a big game, two managers. United, Jose will always want to prove something against people who may have doubted him, and he's going to Old Trafford again. I think they would have won it if Bale was fit, but let's see how it goes. Because Son will also be out, I think.
Quite a fantastic interview with Ken Andrew. Very robust indeed in terms of his analysis and spot on, giving his remarks and opinions as far as matters English Premier League football and the fixtures and major headlines in the world of international football is concerned. It's been quite an epic one. I think Fadhili Athmani, our workaholic assistant producer, will make sure the links are on and we get to see this after the show. And let's continue with the conversation on and offline at Wasike Maxwell at Touchline Y25 at Y254 channel. Let's just discuss and exchange views with regards to what happens in the world of football. Chelsea against Crystal Palace still scoreless, and we're hoping that it will be, you know, matches full of goals this particular evening. City against Leeds, where are you putting your money? I also
Manchester
looking
City.
Forward that Leeds will pull a surprise.
Nah, City will win it.
City will wake up from the slumber after a demolition against Leicester City last weekend. It's been an honor having you on board. Thank you for watching the show. Until next time, same time, same place. My name is Maxwell Wasike. Have a good afternoon.